Willkommen, guten Abend, meine Damen und Herren, sehr geehrte Frau Professor Kaisy-Friemuth, sehr geehrter Herr Professor Israel Yuval, meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren und Freunde des Jüdischen Museums und der Akademieprogramme des Jüdischen Museums. Mein Name ist Sini Rosbach. Ich bin kommissarische Leiterin der Akademieprogramme der Michael-Blumenthal-Akademie und Veranstaltungskuratorin des Jüdischen Museums. Ich begrüße Sie sehr herzlich heute Abend zu unserer Veranstaltung mit dem Thema »Wie hältst du es mit Jesus? Judentum, Islam und Christentum?« Es ist der dritte Abend der jüdisch-muslimischen Ringvorlesung mit dem Titel »Der Glaube der anderen Weltreligionen im Spiegel von Judentum und Islam«, die von unserem jüdisch-islamischen Forum organisiert wird. In unserer ersten Veranstaltung im November ging es um das wechselseitige Verhältnis und um das Bild, das Judentum und Islam über die Jahrhunderte hinweg voneinander hatten. Vor zwei Wochen haben wir uns der Frage gewidmet, wie Judentum und Islam die hinduistischen Traditionen, Glaubenslehren und die Götterwelt, die den Vorstellungen der beiden Religionen so gegensätzlich erscheinen, betrachten. Die heutige Veranstaltung, die dritte in der Reihe der Ringvorlesung, widmet sich der jüdischen und muslimischen Sicht auf das Christentum. Anders als beim Hinduismus existiert im Fall des Christentums eine lange Geschichte theologischer Auseinandersetzungen, sodass beide Religionen damit auf eine reiche Tradition der eigenen Verhältnisbestimmungen gegenüber dem Christentum zurückblicken können. Worin ähneln sich jüdische und muslimische Perspektiven auf das Christentum und wo gehen sie auseinander? Und wird die Vielfalt der christlichen Konfessionen und der unterschiedlichen theologischen Positionen wahrgenommen? Es ist uns eine große Freude, für den heutigen Abend zwei ausgewiesene Expertinnen begrüßen zu dürfen, Professor Israel Yuval und Professor Maha Kaisy-Friemuth. Lassen Sie mich nun unseren ersten Referenten vorstellen, Herrn Professor Israel Yuval. Er ist Professor für jüdische Geschichte an der Hebräischen Universität in Jerusalem. Von 2002 bis 2012 war er akademischer Leiter des interdisziplinären Forschungszentrums für jüdische Studien an der Hebräischen Universität Jerusalem. Seit 2012 ist er Leiter des Mendel Institutes for Advanced Studies, auch an der Hebräischen Universität. Für seine Verdienste um das Verständnis zwischen Christen und Juden wurde er 2016 mit dem Bundesverdienstkreuz ausgezeichnet. Yuval gilt als der erste Wissenschaftler, der das Modell vom Judentum als Mutter und dem Christentum als Tochterreligion in Frage gestellt hat und damit dem Verständnis einer wechselvollen, stets aufeinander bezogenen Entwicklung der beiden Religionen den Weg gebahnt hat. Zu seinen bedeutendsten Publikationen gehört das auch auf Deutsch erschienene Buch »Zwei Völker in deinem Leib – gegenseitige Wahrnehmung von Juden und Christen«. Kurz noch ein Wort zu dem Verlauf dieses Abends. Die beiden Referentinnen werden nach ihren Vorträgen die Gelegenheit erhalten, miteinander zu diskutieren, bevor wir auch Ihnen, dem Publikum, die Möglichkeit geben, Fragen zu stellen und mitzudiskutieren. Ich möchte Sie noch mal darauf hinweisen, dass die heutige Veranstaltung auf Englisch stattfindet. Und Sie, wir sind, glaube ich, aus, hoffentlich schon die Übersetzungsapparate genommen haben. Unsere beiden Übersetzerinnen heute Abend in den Kabinen hier hinten sind Annette Wolf und Maike Hopp. Ich möchte noch einen sehr herzlichen Dank aussprechen an Sophia Nowak, die das Jüdisch-Islamische Forum der Akademieprogramme und damit auch diese Reihe der Ringvorlesungen verantwortet. Und eben einen solchen herzlichen Dank geht auch an Stefan van Zwoll und dem Team der Veranstaltungsabteilung für ihren Einsatz für uns alle. Nun wünsche ich uns einen anregenden Abend und bitte Herrn Professor Yuval auf die Bühne. Dankeschön.
Dankeschön. Guten Abend. Ich möchte zunächst der Michael Blumenthal Akademie der Jüdischen Museums Berlin und besonders Frau Sophia Nowak dafür danken, dass Sie mich eingeladen haben, von Jerusalem nach Berlin zu kommen, um über meinen Landsmann Jesus zu sprechen, der in seinem Leben Jude war und er erst nach seinem Tod Christ wurde. Ich entschuldige dafür, dass ich Englisch spreche, aber wie gesagt, Sie sind eingeladen, Ihre Fragen nach der Vorlesung auf Deutsch zu stellen. Und jetzt wechsle ich ins Englische. The Talmudist biblical commentator and Kabbalist, Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman, known as Ramban, defined in the 13th century the root of the Jewish refusal to accept Christianity. According to him, it is the Christian belief in Jesus as the Son of God. According to him, it is the reason why Jews refused to accept Christianity was the Christian belief in Jesus as the Son of God. I quote, if it works. Oh, sorry. Mein Fehler. Here is the quotation. Ramban says, "The main controversy that separates us from you Christians is what you say about God. And it is a very bitter matter. What you believe and the core of your faith is something that the mind cannot accept. And it contradicts nature. And the prophets never said such a thing, namely, that the creator of heaven and earth would enter the belly of a Jewish woman and stay there for 9 months, and she will give birth to a small child. Then he would grow up, and then he will be handed over to his haters and sentenced to death. Then you say that he was resurrected and returned to his first place. This is inconceivable by a Jew or by anyone. This is the crux of our disagreement with you." It seems that Ramban expresses an authentic and sincere view. There is no denying of Jesus' historical existence, but only of the wondrous stories told about him. It rejects the supernatural events associated with Jesus' life on the grounds that they contradict the common sense. This position raises difficulties. Why could the Jews not believe in miracles reported by the New Testament while accepting the miracles told by the Torah, the New Testament, during the Exodus from Egypt, the crossing of the Red Sea, and the revelation on Mount Sinai? In the Middle Ages, the Jewish answer would be that the miracles of the Torah were witnessed by the whole people of Israel, while the testimonies of Jesus' birth and resurrection are of individuals. The descent of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost, narrated in Acts 2, occurred in a room in which only a few dozens of people were present, whereas the revelation of God in Sinai was before the whole people. However, this does not fully explain Ramban's claim that the miracles upon which Christianity was founded contradict the common sense. After all, the parting of the Red Sea also contradicts nature. If God can speak to humans, why can't he get into their belly? In my opinion, Ramban's position expresses a fundamental difference between Judaism and Christianity. The importance of the Exodus and the revelation of Mount Sinai, the two founding events of Jewish religion, lies not in the occurrences of miracles. The biblical faith is based on a covenant between God and his people, not on miracles. The slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt became the servants of God on Mount Sinai, and in exchange for their loyalty, God gave them the promised land. Maimonides, the famous Jewish philosopher, formulated it well. I quote, you don't have it on the PowerPoint. I quote from Maimonides. "Israel did not believe in Moses because of the miracles that he made. Anyone whose faith requires miracle has a flaw in his faith, because miracles could be done in trickery or by magic." End quote. Maimonides does not deny the fact that the Torah tells of miracles made by Moses to Israel, but according to him, these miracles were necessary in order to liberate Israel from Egypt, not to prove their faith in God and Moses. Indeed, Orthodox Jews till today do not feel threatened by the fact that the Exodus has not received any historical or archaeological confirmation. To them, Jewish religion is not based on the historicity of the event told by the Torah. It is not regarded as the Torah is not regarded as a historical book that accurately reports events which took place 3,500 years ago. The Israeli philosopher Meir Buzaglo puts it nicely. In his opinion, Jewish faith is not based on reporting, but on transmission from generation to generation, from parents to their children. I quote from him. Transmission requires an intimate connection between the transmitter and his recipient. The recipient is devoted to the one who delivered it. He is loyal to him and not only believes in him, end quote. Christian faith, however, is based on the historical account of the Gospels, whose miraculous and supernatural element is salient. As Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, I quote, if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is our faith. The church requires the belief in Jesus' incarnation and divinity as a condition for salvation. When the filmmaker Mel Gibson produced The Passion of the Christ about 10 years ago, he was heavily criticized for portraying the crucifixion story in accordance with the anti-Jewish attitude of the Gospels. Jews in America feared that the movie would re-energize anti-Semitism. In my opinion, Gibson could not have done otherwise. Being a faithful Christian, he had to accept the evangelical reporting as a historical event. Therefore, one could expect medieval Jews to deny the facts told by the New Testament concerning the crucifixion of Jesus. Matthew puts in the mouth of the Jews the horrible phrase, I quote, let his blood be upon us and on our children. Thus blaming not only the Jews present at the crucifixion, but all Jews in future generations. This sentence justified the persecutions of the Jews during the First Crusade in 1096. According to the Hebrew Chronicle, the Crusaders said to themselves before embarking on their long voyage, I quote, we are going a long way to seek the Holy Sepulchre, and here are the Jews sitting among us, whose fathers killed and crucified him. Let us take revenge from them first and extinct them as a nation. Curiously, however, throughout the Middle Ages, Jews did not refute the facticity of the stories of the New Testament. They did not deny the claim that they crucified Jesus, even though, according to the New Testament, the crucifixion itself was executed by the Romans, not by the Jews. A definite representative of this position is the work, a work called Toldot Yeshu, meaning the history of Jesus, a kind of a Jewish gospel that no one knows clearly when and where it was composed. Some precede it into the third or first centuries, while others postpone it to the 8th or 9th century. And so it is told in one of its versions, and I make you a synopsis of it. During the reign of King Herod, so the text says, there lived a man named Joseph, who was married to a woman named Maria. Joseph was God-fearing. He had a neighbor, a wicked one, And his name was John, who was an adulterer. Miriam was a handsome woman, and evil Joan wanted to sleep with her. Once, on Passover's night, Joseph went to the house of study. After Joseph left the house, the evil Joan entered and found Miriam lying in bed, and she was in her menstrual cycle. The evil lay with her. Miriam thought he was her husband and shouted at him, "Don't you know that I'm unclean? Don't do this bad deed." But he didn't hear to her voice. And when dawn came, Joseph returned to his house and found his wife crying. He said to her, "How did you do this bad deed?" She said to him, "You have committed a serious offense, and although you knew I am unclean, you slept with me twice tonight as one of the most wicked. What madness held you?" Answered Joseph, "I didn't sleep with you. Maybe you had a dream and thought I was him. Shut up and don't talk about this anymore." In fact, Joseph realized that his neighbor did this. He went to his rabbi, Shimon ben Shattach, and told him that he suspected the evil John of doing this. The rabbi said to him, "My son, you have no witness. Shut up and tell nothing." Joseph said, "If I stay here, I will be ashamed because Miriam may have become pregnant, and this will become known." He asked his permission to go to Babylon. The rabbi said to him, "My son, go in peace." Later, it is told that Miriam was found pregnant, and everyone knew that the boy was not Joseph's because he had left for far away. The people rumbled about the boy, and only Miriam continued to believe that her husband was his father and her son was not a bastard. So far, the Jewish version of the story of Jesus' birth. We have heard of Jesus here as a bastard, born to an unclean mother and an abandoned child raised without a father. Historian Amos Funkenstein called this story counter-narrative. It takes the basic facts told in Matthew's gospel and offers them a different interpretation, turning them from a miraculous birth of the Son of God into an obscene story about the birth of a bastard. The gospel is thus the basic story upon which the Jewish narrative was built. As a second layer, hostile, but not denying the facts told in the first one. But can the story of Jesus' birth, as it is told in Matthew, really be considered the earliest layer? Does it lie, if we use the archaeological language, on the bedrock? The answer, to my opinion, is negative. If we read carefully the corresponding story in Matthew's Gospel, we can clearly discern an earlier layer. Here is the story. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Jesus, in Hebrew, Yeshu, Yoshua, means the Savior. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. And here comes a quotation from Isaiah. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Immanuel. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son. And he gave him the name Jesus. The story of Matthew seeks to substantiate the claim of the conception of Mary from the Holy Spirit with the help of two references, Joseph's dream and Isaiah's prophecy. The story raises difficulties. If Isaiah's prophecy came true in Jesus' birth, why did the angel command Joseph to call his son Jesus and not Immanuel? The simple solution is that verses 22-23 that you have in red color are a later interpolation. Indeed, if we pull these two verses out of the story, a logical sequence will be obtained. The angel commanded Joseph to call his newborn Jesus, and so Joseph did. This is the original story. Why then was the interpolation added? Because the original story caused difficulties. The narrator does not hide the fact that Joseph was suspicious that Mary had forbidden sex. His purpose is to contradict Joseph's suspicion. And to this end, he recruits Joseph himself, who tells of his dream in which the angel told him that Mary become pregnant by the Holy Spirit. This is a weak explanation for three reasons. First, a dream is a personal event that has no external testimony. So how did Matthew, who lived a century later, learn of Joseph's dream? Second, Joseph must have had a personal interest in clearing his wife of any suspicion, because according to Jewish halakha, Jewish religious law, a married or engaged woman who had sex with another man is forbidden to her husband, and her son is a bastard. Third, the claim of conception by the Holy Spirit is problematic, because from now on, any woman can justify a forbidden pregnancy by claiming to be pregnant from the Holy Spirit. I suppose these difficulties with the dream's explanation drove the narrator to call upon a stronger reference, the prophecy of Isaiah. As a result, the Matthew story consists of three layers. The first layer is the suspicion of Joseph. The second layer is the attempt to explain Mary's pregnancy through the dream and the angel's words. In the third layer, the prophecy of Isaiah was added. It is likely that the retrospective interpretation that Jesus' birth was a miracle was not created during his lifetime, but only after his crucifixion and resurrection. If this reconstruction is correct, Matthew created a counter-narrative for an earlier version, which he wanted to refute. According to this, the Jewish story in Toldot Yeshu is not a counter-narrative to the story of the New Testament, but vice versa. The New Testament story is a counter-narrative to an all earlier story which Toldot Yeshu revived. As mentioned, Jews did not rule out the very facts told in the Gospels, as we have just heard, but only their interpretation. The facts were recruited for the needs of Jewish propaganda. A similar position is also expressed in the Talmudic literature, in which Jesus is portrayed as a historical figure of a cheater and a sinner who has been condemned to death but with the consent of the rabbis. This Jewish willingness to plead guilty to the crucifixion is surprising, as it goes beyond the accusation in the New Testament. According to the Gospels, the Jews only initiated the crucifixion and asked the Romans to crucify him. They gave up the opportunity to spare his life, even when Pilate offered to pardon him. But the Gospels do not claim that Jews executed Jesus. The trial was conducted by the Roman governor, and those who crucified him were Roman soldiers. Strangely, the Talmud does not think so. The Mishnah, the canon of the so-called oral law, the halakha, states that a death penalty must be publicly proclaimed to allow someone to testify and rescue the convicted at the last minute. This is the Mishnaic law, that you have to proclaim it before the execution. To this, the Talmud, which comes later, raises an objection based on another Mishnaic source, which tells that when Jesus was crucified on the eve of Shabbat, the sentence was proclaimed not shortly before the crucifixion, as the Mishnah requires, but 40 days earlier. So we have here an objection. The Talmud's implicit assumption is, therefore, that the crucifixion of Jesus was performed in accordance with Jewish law, and therefore it could not contradict the procedure of the Mishnah. Otherwise, there is no contradiction. A similar picture emerges in many rabbinic sources. I give just one example from the Middle Ages. In the 13th century, Rabbi Yehiel of Paris defended Judaism in a trial conducted against the Talmud in Paris. Rabbi Yehiel did not deny the act of crucifixion, but argued that the same Jesus whom the sages killed was not the Christian savior, but another man named Jesus who lived two generations before him. This traditional Jewish apologetics lasted throughout the Middle Ages until modern time, until the 19th century. Jews accepted throughout the generations the role that Christianity had assigned them, to be Jesus crucifiers and to claim that he was worthy of his punishment. One reads and wonders why none of them made the simplest argument: we did not kill Jesus, but the Romans. Only in the 19th century did this trend reverse, and the new Jewish apologetics sought to acquit the Jews of the crucifixion charge. At the same time, a positive Jewish attitude towards Jesus arose. Historian Joseph Klausner wrote his book on Jesus in the 1920s with deep sympathy for him. Author Aaron Abraham Kabak wrote his historical novel called In the Narrow Lapse in the 1930s, in which he calls Jesus our Jew. Israeli scholar David Flusser calls Jesus Rabbi Jesus, Jesus. And Supreme Court Judge Chaim Cohen wrote in the 1950s his book, The Trial and Death of Jesus Christ, in which he endeavored to prove the impossibility of claiming that Jesus was executed under rabbinic law. In his autobiography, published long after his death, he recounts the circumstances that led him to write his book. He tells the following. In 1948, not long after the establishment of the Supreme Court and the establishment of the State of Israel, I was then the state's attorney. And I was called to Moshe Zemora, the first president of the Supreme Court. He showed me several overflowing cases, which included petitions to the Supreme Court of Israel to retrial Jesus Christ. The petitioners were Protestant pastors from Scandinavian countries, and they all claimed that at the time of the resumption of the Supreme Court in a Jewish state, the first duty that is imposed on it is to correct the 1900 years old distorted verdict of its predecessor, the Sanhedrin. The president of the Supreme Court told me that he convened the judge, and they, of course, decided that they had no competence to relate to these petitions. He knew about my love of Hebrew law and my proficiency in Roman law and handed these files to me. Maybe I would be interested to look at them and investigate the subject. I was slowly browsing through those files, and I was caught up in the investigation of Jesus Christ's trial. Even before the Jewish historians, jurists, writers of the 20th century, there were some converts in the Middle Ages, late Middle Ages, and early modern period who were perhaps the first who exposed Jesus' Judaism. They were those sitting on the fence, seeing the good and the beautiful aspects on both sides. A few of them tried to build a bridge across an abyss of hatred, and in this respect, they could be recognized as the spiritual ancestors of researchers nowadays. Sometimes, someone who was considered one side's traitor could be later be recognized as the only holder of the truth. This was the fate of the most famous traitor in history, Judas Iscariot, who was initially synonymous with Jewish treachery towards Jesus. Thus, until the 1990s, when a new second century gospel was discovered in Egypt, the Gospel of Judah. Here, in this new discovered gospel, Judah is presented as the most faithful disciple of Jesus and the only one who knew his divine attributes. At Jesus' request, Judas hands him over to the high priest and helps him ascend to the cross and die so that he can atone for the sins of humanity and become a supreme God. This upheaval in Judah's image from ultimate traitor to one who secretly knew the truth is a motivating factor in Amos Oz's novel Gospel According to Judas, one of his last books before his death about a year ago. Amos Oz's Gospel According to Judas implicitly corresponds with José Saramago's Gospel According to Jesus. Both writers offer an alternative story to the one told in the New Testament. Christians have claimed for 2,000 years that Jews are blind, and because of their blindness, they do not understand the Old Testament. Amos Oz claims that for 2,000 years, the Christians were blind, and because of their blindness, they did not understand the New Testament. Amos Oz talks about Judah, but probably means himself, a leftist considered in Israel by extreme rightists to be a traitor. I wish to conclude my lecture with Reuven Rubin painting. First Seder in Jerusalem, painted in 1950, so shortly after the foundation of the State of Israel, which has a clear allusion to Leonardo da Vinci's Last Supper. I'm sorry for the bad quality that I found in the internet. As you know, according to the three synoptic gospels, the Last Supper was a Seder night of the Feast of Passover. There is, by the way, another. This is a photo of a Last Supper Israeli version, putting here soldiers, which also imitate Leonardo da Vinci, but I will not discuss. This was made by Adi Ram, but I will not discuss this one, but the next one. And here it comes. This is the painting of Rubin. Rubin, as you can see, places Jesus inside the banquet, but not in his usual place in the center, but on the left margin, an anguished and detached figure. In the center of the Seder, or the Last Supper, he places a Hasidic Rebbe. A muscular Zionist pioneer is seated next to him. They both have the same color of the clothes. And he is the pioneer, the Zionist pioneer, is the only one of the participant to look at him. The other participant represents the so-called kibbutz galuyot, the ingathering of the exiles in the days following the establishment of the State of Israel. We have a Yemenite family here, and a family from Sudan. And here you can see a European family, and this is the painter himself, Rubin, with his wife and his child. Pay attention to the painter's biblical sandals here, and the barefoot of which are these sandals are the symbol of Israelishness, the so-called biblical sandals, and the bare feet of Jesus sitting opposite him. Unlike the Last Supper, Rubin's Seder takes place outside the city of Jerusalem. You see, we are outside the city. There is a path leading outside. And in this location, one can also see the Judean desert outside, in the eastern side of the city, in the background. It seems to me that Rubin chose the place of the first Seder dinner on Mount Scopus, where one can see both the Judean desert and the old city. The three vaults here, which of course will remind you, here you have also three windows, and in Leonardo da Vinci also the three windows. But here they are in form of an arch, and they remind me the Hebrew University amphitheater on Mount Scopus. And why would Rubin place this Last Supper Seder evening on the location of the university? Maybe because the founders of the Hebrew University in 1925 saw it as the third temple, but a temple of wisdom instead of a temple of worship to God. The introduction of Jesus into the heart of this Jewish Zionist discourse is a testament of the new status Jesus gained in modern Israel. No longer a bastard, but one who watches and the revived Jewish state and is one of its agents. Is Jesus' return to the Israeli consciousness the result of the Jewish return to the land of Israel and to its landscapes, or vice versa? The immigration from Europe provoked longing for Europe through an identification with Jesus, the Jew of Nazareth, who became in European culture a European icon. An open question. Thank you.
Big open question. Vielen herzlichen Dank, Professor Yuval. Nun möchte ich unsere zweite Referentin vorstellen. Maha Kaisy-Friemuth ist Professorin für islamisch-religiöse Studien an der Friedrich-Alexander-Universität Erlangen-Nürnberg. Sie war wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiterin im Fach muslimisch-christliche Beziehungen an der Katholischen Universität Löwen und Dozentin am Trinity College Dublin. Sie beschäftigt sich mit der Erforschung der rational-theologischen Schule der Mu'tazila und hat 2019 einen Band Rationalität in der islamischen Theologie mit herausgegeben. Sie hat sich auch mit den Vorstellungen über menschliche Seele im Judentum, Islam und Christentum beschäftigt und konnte zeigen, dass diese Vorstellungen im großen Maße von griechischer Philosophie beeinflusst sind. Mit Frau Professor Kaisy-Friemuth dürfen wir eine herausragende Kennerin des antiken Christentums bei uns begrüßen. Vielen Dank.
Thank you very much for inviting me to this very interesting opportunity, first of all, to be together with one of very important professors from the Hebrew University. And to be here also in the Jewish Museum and to talk about Islam is a perspective of Jesus or Jesus in the Islamic tradition. I'm going to show some of what we call miniaturen, which are from between the 12th and the 15th century, mainly from Persian paintings. It's very interesting to see here the Madonna, which is then expressed by Persian painting. And as you see the, how do you call that in English? This holiness, Abba, yeah, is in the paint in the Persian traditions is fire coming around Jesus, which is also comes from very early Persian traditions. It is clear that the Quran has very strong inclusive tradition. With this inclusive traditions, the Quran stands provide itself a good stance in the tradition of Judeo-Christianity. This traditions appears very strongly in the narratives of the Quran. The narratives is mainly given to show how the biblical prophets function in this history between make strongly the relationship between God and humanity. These narratives is giving the story of about 28 prophets. Jesus stands as a very important prophet among these 28 prophets. And these narratives has two sides. On the one hand, they stand as to put the Islamic tradition within or to plant the Islamic tradition within the Christian and Jewish tradition, and to show very clearly that this is not a new tradition, it is a continuation of these two religions. On the other hand, these narratives also tries to interpret the situation which Muhammad himself is happened to him, and the situation with the Meccan and the unbelievers. So that it shows that God is with you, as God helped all other prophets before you, he is stands in your situation, in your story, and is providing all kinds of helps. So this is, as a, the first of all, an important tradition in the Quran, which shows that Jesus is an important figure in the, in this tradition. And he plays a very important role in this tradition. It is Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad who are considered as the most important three prophets in within these 28 prophets mentioned in the Quran. But most of these prophets are biblical prophets. The importance of these three prophets lays on the fact that that all three of them possess a revealed text. So Moses, the Torah, Jesus, the Injil, and Muhammad, the Quran. And from this point on, we see that Jesus stands there as an important prophet, and he is clearly a prophet came to the Jews, and he is a Jew, and he stands in this tradition strongly, especially in Surat Al-Umran, where we see that Jesus comes from a long history of a Jewish family. The birth of Jesus is in Islam considered as an important part of his mission. It is this birth from Virgin Mary. In contrast to the story we heard just now, Jesus is considered to receive a very important miracle. A miracle which no one else in the history received it before. It is the miracle to be born without a father. Nevertheless, the Quran emphasizes that that is not something which gives him the status of a divine person, but it is a status which is given him as a gift to show that he is a special prophet. This is his special gift. This is his special miracle. And the Quran says it very clearly, it is also Adam was came to live without having a father, just the same as Jesus came to the world without having a father. So this miracle stands as an important sign which puts its finger to point out an important prophet who has a certain miracle. A very interesting, you see here in this painting, Mary with Jesus under the palm. The Christmas story which we know from all Christians, how Jesus came within a group of people surrounded around him is absolutely different than the story of the birth of Jesus in the Quran. The birth of Jesus in the Quran brings Maria in a place totally alone, absolutely with no one beside her. She sits under a palm tree and receives the pain of the birth is coming, and she is totally alone, and she will be only given strength by some angels who comes to give her strength in this horrible situation where she is absolutely left alone with his pregnancy. When the child comes, then the palm tree comes down to her and allows her to get dattel, to get dates, as to strengthen her situation. So this is a very beautiful kind of natural birth, which a mother gets alone with God, with angels, and giving this miraculous birth of Jesus. Besides the miraculous birth, Jesus is also identified with a mission and with receiving the Injil, and he has very many miracles mentioned in the Quran, even more than or even stronger than what you have in the Gospels, like the miracle which is that he made a bird out of thorn and then breathed into the bird, and then it flew. Also, such a miracle which is hardly attributed to any of the prophets. Also, his mission and his Sermon on the Mountain is possibly to be found in scattered verses from in the Quran. And you can see that the Quran is aware of the gospel and its story. And the Quran find it fascinating, this story of Jesus, and pick up this story in different ways and different forms. However, in some places, the Quran has its own standpoint. For example, Jesus on the mountain says, the Torah says that you should fight in a just way, so eye by eye, hand by hand, and so on. But I tell you, love your enemy. Such a strong position does not appear in the Quran, but a similar position which says that do have fight in a just form, but if you forgive, then it's better for you. So this is a standpoint where the Quran did not come to the point of love your enemy. However, although the Quran is fascinated with the story of Jesus and reflected and mirrored in the Quran, nearly in the same way, it has its very strong standpoint, and it is clearly has a position of rejection of the divinity of Jesus. This rejection appears in many places in the Quran. It starts with the rejection of Jesus having a divine body. And a concept which was also spread in Arabia among some of the Christians, mystics who believed that Jesus had a strong divine body and not a normal human body. And to this, the Quran shows in this verse 5 from Surah 575, he and his mother was a woman of truth. They had both to eat their food, was the daily food. So they had a normal body which demanded food and lived as normal human being in a human body. So this was the first rejection of the concept that Jesus might have had a divine body. Strong rejection in many places in the Quran, not only in these verses which is here, but there are also similars of these verses scattered in the Quran. And the strongest rejection and accusation is they do blasphemy who says Allah is Christ, the son of Mary. So this is one of the strongest accusations, as those who believe in the Trinity, they stand in blasphemy. To this comes a very interesting scene, which is expressed in Surah 5, verse 16. Surah 5, verse 116. This scene is shown that Jesus is with God in heaven, and then God asks him, did you, Jesus, son of Mary, did you say to the people to worship me and my mother as gods? So this is a direct question from God to Jesus. Did you do it? The answer of Jesus was, how can I say something, or how can I ever say what I had no right to say? So this is a testimony. This is a testimony from Jesus in the Quran that he actually did not say that what the Christian says about him. So it's a very strong case here, where the Quran made an accusation for those who believe in the Trinity. Although before we have seen that the Quran accepted the whole story of Jesus nearly exactly as it is says, as it is told in the Gospels. The last point in the Quran is the cross, the crucifixion. The Quran in this verse says clearly those Jews who believe that they crucified Jesus, it is not true. They did not crucify him. But it is made to them as if they have crucified him, but they have crucified someone else. This is the Islamic version. But the question is here, why does the Quran come to this point and save Jesus from the crucifixion? What is the point here? Rereading and reading these verses many times, one sees that actually the Quran puts its finger on the core of Christianity. That is the core of Christianity. There is no crucifixion. For the Quran, there is no crucifixion, because crucifixion means that he bears the sins of the humanity which came from Adam until now. And that's not a Quranic theory. The Quran deals with a fall of Adam as a sin which Adam did, but God has forgiven this sin, and that the humanity is out of this sin. There is no, in the Quran, a fallen sin. And that's why there is no reason for the Quran to let Jesus go into this horrible, terrible situation and to be crucified. The Quran says very clearly here, Jesus is the prophet of God, and God will not allow that his prophet will go through all these horrible situation of the cross. So it's not only this duality in the Quran between the Jesus of the Gospels and the Jesus of the Quran, but there is also duality concerning the Christians themselves. As in some places and in many places, it's not only these two verses, there are also other verses, the Christians are accused to have blasphemed concerning the position of Jesus, as or concerning his divinity and concerning the Trinity. But in the same time, in this verse 582 to 83, it shows that it is actually it is the nearest to you, Muslims, are the Christians. They are a believer. They devote themselves to learn, and they are men who have renounced the world, and they are not arrogant. And when they hear the Quran, their eyes are full of tears. So there is this other duality, other difficulty. On the one hand, Christians are accused to be blasphemers, and on the other hand, they are the nearest to the Muslims. What a puzzle which the Quran put in the hand of the Muslims and entrust them with such a big problem. How did the Muslim deal with this problem? These verses were not hidden in the Quran, but they were scattered in the Quran, and it was hard to be a commentator without dealing with those difficult verses, and without also having a standpoint and clearly showing where the Quran is going with the Christians. The earliest commentator is Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas is a cousin of the Prophet, died 688. He was one of the very few commentators who dealt with the whole Quran. He tried to understand how could the Quran have this inconsistency. It is impossible that God once is happy with the Christians and in another time he accuses them. And once he is accepting the Jesus of the Gospels and in another time refuses his divinity. In order to come out of these problems, Ibn Abbas have got a very fascinating idea, which probably also has a lot of truth in it. He says that in Arabia, it was many Christian groups, but we could identify four groups. Those who believed that Jesus is one of three gods, as Allah, Mary, and Jesus himself. And this group was around in Arabia, and they also called themselves Christians. The second group is those who believe that Jesus is the supreme God himself, monophysites. As this group was also in Arabia and showed itself into the Arabian traditions. The third group is that Jesus was not by birth God, so he did not enter Mary's belly, but he became God. And this is also another Christian group. The fourth group, where he Ibn Abbas believes that these are the real and true Christians, those who believe that Jesus is a prophet and is a messenger of God. All four groups were there in Arabia in the 7th century, and the Quran mirrors and refers to all these groups in different forms, and that's how it shows, as if it contradicts itself, as if it has inconsistency, but the reality is more pluralistic as what we believe in, or as what we think. It comes, the second important commentator in this difficult questions, or in these dualities, Saif ibn Umar, from end of 8th century, he believes, or he saw that there is a contradiction between the Gospels and the letters of Paul. And he saw this contradiction that actually the Gospels did not express a clear trinity or divinity of Jesus. It was Paul. It was Paul who introduced this kind of blasphemy, this kind of divinity of Jesus, and introduced this trinity. It was also Paul who allowed gave the Christians, the early Christians, the advice that they are more free of the Jewish tradition, and they are not standing in the Jewish tradition. That's why they are not in need anymore of circumcision. So they are free to eat also pork. The point for Saif ibn Umar that he believed that Paul was trying to evangelize to the Roman, and for the Roman, the concept of a divine human is not a strange concept. So he, from his point of view, from Omar's point of view, he was selling them a kind of a cheap kind of Christianity. Then we come to another, a later theologian who wrote a very important book of the proofs for the prophecy of Muhammad, Tathbit Dala'il al-Nubuwa. And he put another person into this chain, and this is the Emperor Constantine. It is Constantine who spread this kind of concept, this Trinity, through the Concile of Nicaea in 325. And accused Arius and his followers who believed in the createdness of the Son of God and the eternity of God alone. Abdul Jabbar, in his book, tries to argue that it was actually the final who gave birth to this kind of Trinity is Constantine and the council, the first council of Nicaea, which produced this Trinity, which is not the correct form of Christianity. It's not the one which Jesus preached. Coming to the modern period, we have the beginning, the first year, an Orientalist, Louis Shaiho, who wrote a very interesting book, The History of Christian Literature. He tried to present more analysis to the context of the Quran, and he showed that there was a lot of heretical Christian groups spread among the Arabs in Arabia. One of this group, for example, is the Maryamiyin. And the Maryamiyin is a group which is also mentioned by the 13th century theologian Ibn Taymiyyah, who mentioned in his book, who mentioned that the Maryamiyin is a group who adored and worshipped Miriam and built churches for her and prayed to her. So this group could be representative for the concept or for the idea that Maria is a god. And the accusation in the Quran that the Trinity consists of Allah, Maria, and Jesus. It is not an accusation of the Quran, but it is a fact of a group which really existed in this period. Then another group who Shaykhu considered as a heretical group is the Jewish Christian. The Jewish Christian is a very interesting group which many of the Muslim theologians tried to see in them the light that these are the real Christians whom the Quran talks about them, that these are the ones who are the closest to the Muslims. The Jewish Christians are groups of Christians who did not denounce Judaism, but carried Judaism in their belief of Christianity and believed in Jesus as a prophet and only a prophet. El-Jabri is a Moroccan philosopher and theologian, died just recently, 10 years ago. He, in his book, Introduction to the Quran, dealt with these problems of the different groups which are mentioned in the Quran, and he identified the real Christians as the disciples of Jesus. The real Christian for him is those disciples who followed Jesus, who were together with Jesus, and especially the Quran talks about them as those who followed Jesus and who said, "We are Allah's followers, Nasara. We believe in Allah and do bear witness that we are Muslims." This concept that Islam as being submitted to God is a concept which appears a lot in the Quran. The Quran calls Jesus Muslims, he calls Abraham Muslims, and in other prophets as well, as Christian, as Islam, a kind of a submission for the concept of believing on the one God alone. Now we come to the last group, which is a very interesting group. It's the only group where they are willing to accept Jesus as he is and as we know him also among the Christians, the Sufis. The Muslim Sufis have a strong connection to a kind of an internal religion where they have God in the center and the love of God is their concern and their only form of religiosity. The aim of the Sufis is the nearness of God, but also the union with God. Those Sufis are the groups, the Muslim groups, who could identify a kind of relationship which allows the human to develop himself totally in the love of God, that he disappears or she disappears in this love and it remains in full pleasure of union with God. They consider that Jesus was one of the few human beings who could enjoy this perfect union with God, and he enjoyed the perfect form of annihilation where he was totally drawn by God, that he would not be able to see himself. There is an interesting book appeared in the last 10 years, The Muslim Jesus, and tried to collect all the sayings of the Sufis on Jesus in order to form a kind of a sunnah, the sunnah of Jesus as the sunnah of Muhammad. So finally, I come to an end to say that for the Muslims, Jesus, Al-Masih, Isa ibn Maryam, he is a very special prophet, passed through a special union with God, but He is not God. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Kaisy-Friemuth. We would like to, those were two very fascinating inputs. Thank you, and for our discussion. We would like you to give you the opportunity to respond to each other's talks and discuss some on the stage, and then we would like to open up the discussion to questions from the audience. I would like to start perhaps with a question, and interrupt me if you have questions for each other, please. With the idea of the Trinity that you've spent some time considering in your talk, and I would like to pose that question to Professor Yuval, that the religious, what is the Jewish response to the concept of Trinity? Is it considered, you were talking about blasphemy, is it considered idol worship in Judaism? Is there, what is the sort of religious response to the question of Trinity that came up?
It is interesting that I began my talk with a quotation from Nachmanides, from Ramban. He does mention Trinity as a problem, although it is clear for all Jewish sources that in Jewish eyes there is a basic difference in its attitude between Islam and Christianity. Islam was regarded as a monotheistic religion by Jews in the Middle Ages, whereas Christianity was idolatry. And it was idolatry because of the Trinity. This is the main reason, and this is what makes, in that theological aspect, Judaism and Islam very close to each other. And I think also if we consider the reaction in practical ways of Jews in the Middle Ages to Christianity, if we take as an example the reaction of in the First Crusade, how Jews reacted when they had to face the alternative between conversion to Christianity or death, and their choice was to die as martyrs. This is exactly because Christianity was regarded as idolatry. And if I compare this pattern of behavior to something that happened about 100 years later in Spain, when the Almohadun monarchy came to power and tried to coerce to force Islam on Christians and Jews in Muslim Spain, Maimonides and his family responded by embracing Islam. Of course, as a forced conversion, but they preferred to convert to Islam than to die. And this difference in their behavior shows that there was a fundamental difference or differentiation in the Jewish attitude to Islam and to Christianity. And the fundamental difference was the concept of Trinity as idolatry, as a non-monotheistic concept of God. I would just, if I may, add one important point. As far as I can judge from what I learned from the Jewish sources, I have the impression that Jewish thinkers did not, in fact, took the pain to really understand the concept of Trinity, what it really means, because Christians did not believe in three gods. This is not the way Christian theology would understand it. But for Jews, the very fact that there is a Father, a Son, and the Holy Spirit, what was considered as a simple Trinity and then four as idolatry.
which in Islam seems to in the Islamic commentators' reception of Christianity, that seems to play a role. That there is that distinction between this self-perception of Christianity as monotheistic, and still the problem of the three instances.
Well, I think that an important element, an important factor in this harsh accusation in the Quran, blasphemy, is a result of the situation itself. In Mecca, there was a lot of polytheism, in Deutsch, and the anti-Muslims, the kuffar of Medina, they all believed in many gods, on a number of gods, and it was very clear that Islam comes now with a new concept, with a new idea. And the conception of monotheism, although it had some introduction among the Arabs before Islam, there was a kind of monotheism, which is saying, for example, that the gods has a godhead at the top of them, and that the godhead also was called Allah. But because of this situation, the Quran was very strongly acting against whoever in this tradition where it wants to plant itself in this Jewish-Christian tradition. So it wanted to show that it has also a standpoint or a correcting point in order to fit into this image, into this build. So that it is a continuation of Judaism and Christianity. And in order to be a continuation, it has to correct this problem between monotheism and polytheism. And that's why it took itself this very strong element, on the one hand, to praise the Christian and to praise Jesus, on the other hand, to stand completely and clearly against the concept which is contradict monotheism, whatever the concept is, whether it's a trinity or 40 or whatever contradict monotheism is absolutely in the target for the Muslims. But I agree that the Muslims afterwards did not take on themselves this effort in order to understand this kind of trinity, which is in form of monotheism as well. Some theologians tried to defend a form of Christianity which does not goes to the extent of the Trinity, but to put Jesus on a very high level that one can think that Jesus has a divinity character in him. This was possible. But this polytheism remained always a very strong burden, which a Muslim very hard to accept.
Another aspect that I found interesting was is the aspect of faith and big differences in Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. On the you were talking in the beginning of the function of miracles as you know that in Judaism, if I understood correctly, miracles are an expression of the covenant of the people with God, and not as a proof of faith, as it is in Christianity. And if you could respond to that.
Faith is important in Judaism, but doesn't stand as a necessity. What counts is what you do, not what you believe. And I can give a very clear example. In Christianity, we have the credo. Maimonides, whom I mentioned before, tried to create a Jewish credo of 13 principles that you have to believe. One God, the Exodus from Egypt, the coming of the Messiah, etc. 13 principles. A few generations later, another Jewish philosopher, Albo, wrote a book in which he refuted and denied. He said, no, we don't need 13. This is too much. Three are enough. But in fact, faith was never defined in a clear way. And there are always discussions about almost every aspect in Jewish faith. Take, for example, the belief in the coming of the Messiah, which people think this is in the fundamentals of Jewish faith. There are rabbis in the Talmud who said that Israel will never have Messiah anymore. He already came. So you can see in many aspects, of course, you have to believe in God, but you have to believe in God in order to fulfill the mitzvot, the commandments of God. Faith as such is only a precondition and not a value of itself in classical Judaism. And if I may add, one of the reasons is because Jews never had a church. They never had an establishment. If you have two rabbis, you have two opinions, and they never agree. Or maybe if you have two rabbis, you have three opinions. So that the ability to define a theology is alien to Judaism. There is no Jewish theology in that sense. Maimonides wrote the book of the Perplexed, and even before he died, there were a big discussion about the book a generation after his death, and the book was rejected by many Jewish rabbis. So there was no establishment that could even enforce one theology, so that we have many possibilities of faith. And what counts, look, we have now, if I may be actualized, you have a Jewish group of the Lubavitcher Hasidim, who, this is a group of Hasidim in New York who believed that their rabbi, Schneerson, who died, I think, in the early 90s, was a Messiah. And after, they believed that he is a Messiah during his lifetime, and after he died, they believed that he didn't die, that he is still alive. And nobody, except of one historian, David Berger, in America, but nobody even had the idea to eliminate them from Judaism. Although their belief is very reminiscent of the Christian belief in a living Messiah. And the reason is because they observe the commandments, and this is what matters for Jews.
Actually, in Islam is a similar experience, because we also do not have a church in Islam. We also do not have a religious authority which impose a kind of theology on all Muslims. And there was always different directions in faith. And one can identify, probably, possibly to identify three directions. Those who believed in the Sharia, in the correctness, that there are some rules which the Quran are expressing, and according to this, to those rules, one has to live his life. And then the, in this direction, the Quran is interpreted as a book of norm and of laws, which is different than the nature of the Quran, because the Quran is written in poetry form. And a poetry is always a discussion, is always a way of questioning, of introducing, and of in Deutsch empfehlen, and not putting a rule. A rule cannot be expressed in this beautiful poetry form of the Quran. So this group have really judged the Quran and put the Quran in its in a corner, which is not its nature. The second group is more the intellectual, the rationalist group, where they were trying to interpret and analyze and to see that there are lots of metaphors in the Quran, and the language in itself has many different Bedeutungen, meanings, and it does not, and it is impossible to stop these language and to put the borders and to say a word should be and must be understood in this way. And this direction of rationality was trying to question and to open question and to understand and reinterpret faith and its sources with the Quran. The third direction is the spiritual direction, those of the Sufis, who took the Quran as a beautiful poetry and lived their own spirituality according to what they understand and what the Quran hints for them. They do not follow a certain Sharia. They follow their own way of understanding their faith and Islam and the Quran. This third group is the most likely to accept different religions which probably contradict Islamic belief. So within these three directions, Muslims moves in very many different groups. So we cannot really talk about Muslims as if they are one genre and one people who believe in a certain way, and there is no other way to believe except in this way. Even what I said today about Jesus, possibly there are also other Muslims who have the willingness to accept the Trinity in its philosophical way. And its depth of faith, we know that Christians are very strong believers who have a strong spirituality. And just to put them in the corner to say you are those who believe in the Trinity and that's why you're out is, of course, also not absolutely a full Islamic belief, although it is a lot of Muslims would believe in these directions. but there is also others who are willing to observe this spirituality of Christianity, which is very important point when we talk about faith.
Perhaps let's open up to questions from the audience. There's someone with two lovely hosts with microphones, and perhaps we'll take two questions and then decide to respond. And there were two in the back.
Ich frage meine, stelle meine Frage auf Deutsch. An die Muslime auf dem Podium. Ich finde, wie sieht es denn aus mit dem Vergleichspunkt Koran, die Stellung des Koran, die Bedeutung des Koran und die Bedeutung Jesus Christus im Christentum? Weil das eine ist das unerschaffene Wort Gottes, also das ist ja auch sozusagen nochmal debattiert, und der andere ist sozusagen das fleischgewordene Gottes. Und ich finde immer, die Diskussion Isa auf der einen Seite, Jesus auf der anderen Seite, ist ein bisschen kurz, ist ein bisschen so ein Kurzweg. Und ich finde, es ist interessanter, den Koran mit Jesus zu vergleichen und den Stellenwert in den jeweiligen Religionen.
Vielleicht, let's take another question. Ja, the gentleman here. Ja, hier mit den, genau.
First of all, thank you both for the interesting lecture. I post my question in English so you all can follow. I have a question because you asked Ms. Rosbach about the Trinity, and to me it's strikingly that in Islam there's this strong concept of oneness, of tawhid, right? So my first guess was that Islam would reject Jesus more than Judaism, because as you said, Mr. Yuval, you called him your fellow countryman, right? So, and he was a Jew, and he observed, or it's reported that he observed the mitzvot. So wouldn't it be easy, in my first view, it would be easier to accept Jesus from a Jewish perspective than from an Islamic perspective, because of this oneness of monotheism, which is, I would ask, I don't know if I'm wrong, which is even stronger in Islam, this oneness. Can you say something about this?
Yeah. I will start with the last and then go back. Okay. Yes, of course, it is very difficult for the Islamic monotheism to justify the position of Jesus. And his position of divinity and part of the Trinity. But Islam has taken a certain concept, which is Islam is a continuation of Judaism and Christianity, which means it has to take the consequence. The consequence is those who are considered holy in these two religions must remain holy in Islam. So there is no compromise in this point. But the Quran was actually, I would say, very intelligent to accept the parts which fits into monotheism and then to refute the other parts which does not fit into this monotheism. So that it took this burden as to be consistent in a way. All prophets are from God. God has taken an action in history and acted to save humanity. God himself, he is the savior of humanity in the way that he sends prophets to guide and to bring humanity in his way. So all those prophets are equally God's people. I would say, I was saying before, these are God's folk, so the Israel, those prophets. So it is impossible to take away one of the prophets because it does not fit into the monotheism. But it is intelligently solved the problem to say Jesus, whom you consider as one of the Trinity, is not the Jesus whom actually is expressed in the Gospel and whom God sent as a prophet. So to make this distinction was an important point. The other question, Jesus on the one side and the Quran on the other side, this is a concept which appeared actually among modern theologians, especially from the West, not specifically the Orientalists, but mainly from England, from Montgomery Watt, who was one of the earliest who identified Jesus as the source of Christianity, as the Quran is the source of Islam. This comparison, of course, comes from a Christian point of view, because the Quran is a text, the Quran is clearly is a revealed text which shows who God is. It is a concept in the Quran that God shows himself through texts, through those books. That's why it is one of the Islamic pillars that we have to believe in the Torah. We have to believe in the Injil. And we have to believe in the Quran. And so those texts are the expressions where they reveal God's characters. So the concept that a human can reveal God's character is in some way a Christian concept, which does not really fit into the Islamic tradition.
Yes, I wanted to say something about the allegedly denial of the Jewish denial of Jesus. Jews never denied Jesus. And we have to discern between the historical Jesus and the theological Jesus. The historical Jesus was not a problem for the Jews in his generation. He claimed to be a Messiah. Okay. There were many messiahs. Rabbi Akiva, 100 years later, believed that the Jewish revolt, Bar Kokhba was a messiah. So there was nothing problematic. And even if you take the stories in the Gospels, take the story how Jesus the descent from the Mount of Olives, and how he is welcomed with many followers, with palms, and with the Hebrew word Hoshana, which became the German word Hosanna, yes, save us. Jews in Jerusalem, many Jews, accepted Jesus as Messiah. There was one group who was disturbed, perhaps, a group that belonged probably to the priest. They were worried because this is the theory of Paula Fredrickson, a scholar from Boston, who claimed that the problem, that the anxieties that some Jews had with Jesus was the chaos that he tried to make in the Temple Mount. But even according to the Gospels, many Jews, or some Jews, accepted him as Messiah, and definitely most of the Jews never heard about him, didn't know anything about him. So if we speak about Jewish denial of Jesus, we speak about something that was interpreted centuries later, or a few decades later, when Jews were accused for denying Jesus. But historically, there was no denial. And the reason why he was crucified had probably some very local and a very limited group of people who were disturbed by his presence around the cult of the temple.
Let's take some more questions.
Ja, ich möchte noch etwas zum Trinitätsproblem sagen und darauf hinweisen, Israel Yuval, wenn Sie von Judentum sprechen, meinen Sie ausschließlich rabbinisches Judentum. Denn ansonsten, und da kann ich an den vorigen Direktor dieses Museums erinnern, an Peter Schäfer, der ein wichtiges Buch geschrieben hat, in dem er nachgewiesen hat, dass es auch schon in biblischen Zeiten Annahmen über eine zweite Gottheit im Himmel gegeben hat. Peter Schäfer hat sogar versucht nachzuweisen, dass die kabbalistische Idee der Shekhinah dem christlichen Marienglauben nachempfunden worden ist. Und sogar, wenn man in die biblischen Schriften schaut, findet man Gedanken von einem Kind Gottes, etwa die Chochma im Buch Mishlei, die von Gott gezeugt wurde als seine Tochter. Und last but not least muss man natürlich darauf hinweisen, dass es im hellenistischen Judentum, ich nenne nur Philo, ebenfalls Überlegungen sehr binitarischer Art gegeben hat, dass es einen Logos gab, der der Sohn Gottes gewesen ist. Und ganz etwas Ähnliches steht im Johannesevangelium. Also Sie haben mit allem ganz recht, aber ausschließlich und nur, wenn Sie das strikt rabbinische Judentum meinen.
Vielleicht nehmen wir noch eine zweite Frage hier drüben, bevor wir antworten.
Christen sprechen oft von christlich-jüdischem Abendland, also im Sinne von gemeinsamer theologischer Kultur. Also umgekehrt, aus jüdischer Sicht gibt es das aber doch nicht, ne? Da kann doch eigentlich nur von einem räumlichen Nebeneinander gesprochen werden.
I will try to answer the two questions together, if I may. I agree with you even more than what you have just said. I hesitated whether I want to react to one of the, I believe, the contributions of Islam to Judaism. We also have to think about that. Judaism did not only contribute to other religions, but Judaism was also received very much from Christianity and from Islam. And definitely the notion of pure monotheism was the result of the development in the Middle Ages, especially among Jewish philosophers who lived in Islamic cultural neighborhood, who were influenced by the very pure monotheism of Islam. And if you take, I would take what you have just said and include rabbinic Judaism also. Even in the, first of all, the notion of logos that you mentioned, or wisdom, chokhmah, in the book of the Proverbs, has also in rabbinic Judaism, we have, instead of logos, you have Torah. And the Torah was created, according to the Talmudic legend, the Torah was created before the world was created, and this was the wisdom of God. God created the world while looking at the Torah. So the Torah is a kind of pre-existence of the divine wisdom. I'm an historian, I'm not a theologian. And this means that for me, every idea has a development. And you are perfectly right. If we take the Bible, the Hebrew Bible, the monotheism of the Hebrew Bible is very relative. There is one God, but there are also many other gods. God, Yahovah, is the better one, the supreme God, Elyon, the supreme God. But there are also other gods. And during history there is elaboration. There is, I don't know whether I should call it elaboration, I don't know. But there is a tendency, but toward the monotheism, which I think in the purest and highest level is the result of Islam, definitely. And if you consider monotheism to be a virtue, then Jews should thank Islam for the purification of their concept of monotheism in the Middle Ages. And the rabbis shared many aspects. I just, if I may just take perhaps one example, and you correct me if I'm wrong, concerning Islam. If I understand it correctly, in Islam, you pray by quoting the Quran. And the reason is because if you want to praise God, you have to use God's words. You are not allowed to use human words. This is a very pure, or very, if you want, extreme definition of monotheism. Or another example, you all know that in Muslim calendar, you calculate the year according to the lunar calendar, whereas Jews try to correct the lunar calendar by adding a month once every 2 or 3 years. And Muhammad is against that. And the reason why he is against that, he says, because the lunar calendar is the divine calendar. God created the moon, and the moon was created in order to make the calculation of the year. And you, human being, are not allowed to correct it by mathematics, by calculations, by adding artificially a month to your calendar. So I think these are two examples which clearly show, and I fully agree with you, and we don't need Peter Schaeffer for that, because the Kabbalah is based on the understanding that there are 10 emanations, the Sefirot of God. And the Kabbalah was created in Provence, and then later in Castilia, and was definitely influenced by the very broad definition of Göttlichkeit, of the divinity in Christianity. So things are moving, things are developing, but I was trying to be very, to bring it in a kind of short definition, but you are definitely right. Things are much more complex.
Would you like to add, or then are there more questions? Yes.
Ich war jetzt eben kurzzeitig irritiert, weil Sie, Frau Kaisy-Friemuth, sagten, die Idee von Mohammed war, die reine Lehre nach Medina zu bringen, wo ja, wie Sie sagen, ich wusste das nicht, also eine quasi Vielgötterei schon herrschte. Da frage ich mich, aber wenn jetzt doch das Judentum doch schon existierte seit langen Jahren, das Judentum existierte, als Mohammed auf die Welt kam, nicht wahr? Dann hätte ich es gedacht, sich eher an das Judentum anlehnen können, weil dort ja der Monotheismus also höchste Kultur hatte. Jetzt bin ich natürlich völlig irritiert, nachdem Herr Yuval sagt, also nein, es gab zwar einen Gott da oben, aber wir haben auch vielleicht noch ein paar andere gehabt. Ja, also jetzt bin ich völlig irritiert. So haben Sie es nicht gemeint. Ich habe es dann vielleicht so falsch verstanden. Aber meiner Meinung nach war doch dann der Gedanke von Mohammed, er muss jetzt was ganz Neues kreieren, damit er sich von den anderen absetzt und vor allen Dingen eben von dem vielleicht schon aufkommenden Christentum, das also sich doch ziemlich ausbreitete. Oder gab es andere Gründe noch?
Ich habe es nicht ganz genau verstanden, weil ich habe das
so nicht gesagt. Also ich habe gesagt, dass die...
Ich hatte so verstanden, als Sie sagten, dass Mohammed nach Medina ging, wo viele Götter herrschten und er wollte einen Gott nach vorne bringen, also kreieren oder als Wahrheit hinstellen. Ja, wie war es jetzt mit Medina?
Well, I cannot remember that I said that. If I said it, that I was wrong, because it's not the truth. Yes, it is not the truth. I mean, the move from Mecca to Medina was more or less a political move. It was not a religious move. And Muhammad, when he went to Medina, he was very much aware of the Jews who were in Medina, and he tried to have a good connections with them. And what we call Sahifat al-Madina is one of the earliest Islamic document, which shows clearly that the Jews became a part of the Islamic Ummah. And in this Sahifat al-Madina, the Prophet says that whoever is a Jew is protected from us and is a part of our community, and he stay a Jew. So he did not even try to missionarize them to become Muslim. So this is, if I said that, then it was absolutely misunderstanding, and I don't know, I must have been in a sleep or so. I mean, no, there is the move from Mecca to Medina has no religious aims, but even, of course, Mecca was had this polytheistic characteristic. Yeah, Mecca had the polytheistic characteristic, which allowed the Muslim not to become free in their beliefs. And the Meccan very quickly could perceive that this is what Muhammad is after, is in a way also a political a political new agenda, where he organized especially the poor and the slaves on, to become his followers. And when he gets the slaves from the control of those Meccan aristocrats, then the Meccan would lose a great deal of its strength and of its power. And that's why they were very much against him. Not because he is a Muslim, not because he produced a new religion. This was of no importance at all for them. So the whole thing was political. And when it moved to Medina, it had for the first time its peace, so that it could develop itself to become a state religion and a religion of a state. But I'm sorry if I said something which isn't.
Should we have one last question, or in the back, the gentleman?
I would like to direct a little bit different to a different topic, because both of you mentioned the problematic point of the death of Jesus. And the question was like, what do you think about Jesus? So in Judaism, you quoted the rabbi from Paris, who also said like it was another Jesus that was crucified a few years earlier. And in Islam, it also says in the Quran that Jesus was not crucified, and that is one of the main distinctions between Christianity. It's a Trinity, but it's also actually the death of Jesus, whether we believe it's true or not. So how do you explain that regarding to historical facts of the testimony of the Quran being written around about 700, 800 years later on. And also about that rabbi from Paris who wrote, I assume, like in the 12th or 13th century when he lived, and regarding to the disciples of Jesus and also Josephus Flavius, who was a Jewish scholar, that were actually much closer to the actual event, if you may believe it's true or not. So how do you explain that gap? Like, why do you in both religions, why would you value that historical account more than the ones that were closer to the actual event historically, time-wise? Was my question clear? Like the rabbi you mentioned was like in the 12th century he wrote his account, but the disciples of Jesus did it like within the first century after he...
If I understand you correctly, you raised two questions here. One is the credibility of a rabbi who lived in the 13th century concerning what happened 1300 years earlier. His credibility is null. He doesn't know. He invents a story because this is what he likes. Like all, this is what we all do, no, don't we? We invite stories, and this is the Talmud was attacked in Paris because the Talmud tells, as I told you a little bit, about the crucifixion of Jesus, and you live in a Christian land, so you have to defend yourself. And you say, no, this is not the Jesus that is in the Talmud, it's not the you Christian Jesus. And he invents something else. He says there was another. And if you ask me as an historian, should I grant credibility to what he says? No. It is a credibility that this is what Jews in 13th century France believed. And then the second question is the credibility of the Gospels. And now you are not staying on a solid ground, because the credibility of the Gospels, well, it's not 1300 years later, but only 50 years later, 70 years later. I mean, the Gospels also produce a story which is reflecting what people believed around 70, 80, maybe even 90 CE. So, two generations after the crucifixion of Jesus. And this is what is one of the problems of the historicity of the story in the Gospels, because there is no contemporary confirmation of the story about the historical Jesus, except the famous testimonium Josephus Flavius. And as historians like, this testimony is also is doubted whether it is really was written by Josephus or it is the figment of a later correction and addition of the text. So the big question in history about Testimonium Flavianum, whether it is a really written, by the way, Josephus himself was not an eyewitness. He wrote his books on the Jewish war in Rome about 20 years after Jerusalem was destroyed, so around 90. So he was even not born when Jesus lived. So the question of credibility, of historicity of the stories is a completely complicated question. Let's not deal with that. We are talking about the perception of the religions, how Jews, Muslims perceived Christianity, perceived Jesus, perceived the principle of Trinity or of the divine motherhood of Mary throughout the generations.
Thank you. Thanks very much to both of you, Professor Yuval, Professor Kaisy-Friemuth. I would like to mention die nächste Ringvorlesung mit dem Thema Auf dem Weg zur Erleuchtung, Judentum, Islam und Buddhismus im März, am 12. März um 19 Uhr wieder hier auf der Bühne. Und wir hoffen, dass wir Sie wieder begrüßen dürfen. Und vor allem möchten wir aber jetzt den beiden Referenten sehr, sehr herzlich danken für die Diskussion.